intensive care unit and renal replacement therapy. He was the best outgoing student in MD, received awards like Dr. Balagopal Raju Award for best research paper and Dr. Satyamurthy Gold Medal for during his DM tenure. It's my pleasant opportunity to invite Dr. Srinivasan. You can please share your slides and start your presentation, sir. He'll be talking on approach to a child with toxin ingestion.
Is it audible?
Yes, audible
and the screen is visible.
Thanks for the nice introduction, Bulle Balaji. Good evening, Thanguvila sir, organizing team, my seniors and friends. In the next few minutes, I'll be talking about an approach to a child with toxin ingestion. So 90% of the poisoning in children occur from 9 months of age to 5 years of age. Most of the poisoning are unintentional, but there are also cases of suicidal and homicidal poisoning. Sometimes the poison event is not recognized by the parents or the caregivers. It is not only important to identify what is the poison, but also the amount and route of exposure. In a poisoned child, it needs a good comprehensive history, focused physical examination, and relevant lab evaluation. In this presentation, in addition to approach, I have added a few case scenarios. I have not covered envenomation syndromes. So, as previous speakers have told about initial impression, primary assessment, a child with suspected poisoning should have initial impressions, that is appearance, breathing, and color. In the primary assessment, apart from airway, the breathing may be depressed or child may be tachypneic. Sometimes the child may have acidotic breathing. We'll be discussing about acidotic breathing later. And added sounds like crackles in a child with aspiration. Circulation, whether the child is having bradycardia, tachycardia, hypotension, hypertension, any flushing, cyanosis, etc. In disability, Glasgow Coma scale is preferred rather than AVP scale. How are the pupils, tone, power? In addition to clinical examination, primary assessment, also look for saturation, the bedside ECG model, that is the cardiac monitoring, not the 12-lead ECG monitoring, and capillary blood glucose. In the exposure, look for any spills of the poison, any particular odor, hyperthermia or hypothermia, secretion, sweating, salivation, whether the child is having dry mucosa, oral lesions, ulcers, or lacrimations. So apart from clinical examination, some basic investigations like X-ray, ECG may help in many poisoning. For example, an X-ray may be required in radiopaque poisons like chloralhydrate, calcium salts, heavy metals like lead, mercury, iron, phenothiazine, play dough, that is the colored clay, enteric-coated pills like calcium salts and dental amalgam. In ECG, most of the PR intervals, QRS interval and QT intervals may be prolonged. For example, PR interval is prolonged in digoxin and lithium, whereas QRS prolongation occurs in tricyclic antidepressant, Benadryl, chloroquine, quinine, etc. QT prolongation occurs in antipsychotics, macrolides like erythromycin and clarithromycin, and fungal azoles. There may be hypoglycemia in sulfonylureas, meglitinides, insulin, quinine, ethanol, and propanolol. Some children may have high anemia of metabolic acidosis, that is AGMA, which occurs in methanol, metformin, propylene glycol, INH, iron, ethylene glycol, and salicylate poisoning. So you can remember the mnemonic mud piles. So coming to the management, there are four principles in the management of a poisoned child. So the first one is decontamination, remove whatever the materials available, and enhance elimination, which is what does the enter into the body, remove it as early as possible, particular antidote, and supportive care. These all the principles are equally important in the management of a sick poisoned child. So coming to the decontamination, if you have any spills in the skin or the eyes, you rush with the tepid water or normal saline. If you suspect organophosphorus compound, you cleanse with soap water because the soap has high pH, which removes the phosphate bonds. Avoid flushing with water and normal saline in suspected elemental sodium or phosphorus or calcium oxide or titanium chloride. Avoid ipecac and induced emesis in a poisoned child. You can use gastric lavage with the rice tube and endus. It is recommended within 1 hour of ingestion, but if you don't know the interval or if you feel that the child will be having because of the delayed stomach emptying, you can use gastric lavage. Avoid gastric lavage in a child who is unconscious, who is unable to maintain the airway reflexes, or in corrosive phosphorus acid, alkali, or hydrocarbons like kerosene. So activated charcoal is useful at a dose of 1 gram per kg. It is advised within one hour of ingestion. Most of the cases where you use activated charcoal are carbazepine, phenobarbital, ferritin, dapsone, quinine, theophylline, and salicylate. Activated charcoal is not useful in iron, lithium, hydrocarbons like kerosene, alkalis, acids, electrolytes, alcohol, cyanides. It is controversial to use activated charcoal in pesticides. Coming to enhanced elimination, whole bowel irrigation may be indicated in children with enteric-coated pills poisoning, where you can use polyethylene glycol at a dose of 35 ml per hour. In children with poisoning like SPM, you remember the mnemonic SPM, salicylate, phenobarbital, and methotrexate, where sodium bicarbonate can be used to increase the urinary pH from 8.0 to increase the urinary excretion of the poison. Lipid emulsion at a concentration of 20% may be used in tricyclic antidepressant, calcium channel blockers, and local anesthetic like bupivacaine. You remember the indication for hemodialysis in poisoning, basalt, that is bromide, methyl alcohol, salicylate, ethyl alcohol, lithium, and theophylline. So these are the common antidotes available in poisoning. Atropine is useful in organophosphorus, carbamates, calcium gluconate for hydrogen fluoride, calcium channel blockers, and cyanide kit, which contains amyl nitrate, sodium nitrate, and sodium thiosulfate. For example, in iron poisoning, desferoxamine is used. This is the entire exhaustive list, so I'll be sharing at the end. You can see it leisurely. So these are the potentially toxic compounds which are commonly seen in ICH and all over Tamil Nadu. So in addition, I want to stress the four important household poisons like camphor, eucalyptus, Marpol, that is the naphthalene, and neem oil. All of this poisoning will cause status epilepticus in children. So what are the corrosive household poisoning in children? That is ethylene glycol, toilet cleaner, detergent like soap for detergents, bleaching powder, dishwashing powders. So in this corrosive poisoning, gastric lavage is contraindicated. So coming to the ICH statistics, I took this statistics like a few months back. For the period of 2014 to 2019, there were about 2,10,000 admissions, which in this 0.5% constitute poisonings. Tablet poisoning occurred in 140 children. There was a slightly male predominance, 75 versus 65, among which 50% is by paracetamol. There were no deaths in tablet poisoning except paracetamol. Out of the 12 deaths, all the deaths were due to paracetamol. So others, in others also, there was a male predominance, 2/3 males by and 1/3 by females. The most common is kerosene. Out of 1,100 poisoning, 478 was due to kerosene, followed by mosquito repellent, detergent, and turpentine. In this 1,100 poisoning children, there were 14 deaths, 8 by kerosene, 2 by rat killer and pesticide each, iron poisoning one, and paracetamol one. So in the next few minutes, I'll be talking about a few case scenarios. Case scenario one, a six-year-old boy who was sleeping in the village in the prone position. Father noticed that he is having sweating, salivation. So he turned the child, he was lethargic and he was breathless. So he was immediately taken to a GH where I was working. He was found to have bradycardia, bilateral crackles, and small and reactive pupils. Initially, I was thinking of organophosphorus poisoning, but there was no smell in the mouth. Can anybody smell what it is? So it is organophosphorus. So So you remember the mnemonic dumbbells, which constitute diaphoresis, urination, miasis, bronchorrhea, emesis, lacrimation, and salivation. The child was playing in a cornfield which was sprayed with organophosphorus with a bare body. So through skin absorption, he got all the features of organophosphorus poisoning. So the antidotes are atropine and pralidoxin. Atropine is given at the dose of 0.05 to 0.1 mg per kg. And based on the response of the pupillary reaction, pupillary size, and bronchial secretion, you can increase the dose. And in addition, you can use pralidoxin in organophosphorus compounds. So there are still controversies because of the two RCs done in CMC in the early 1990s, whether pralidoxin is useful or it causes more death. So till now, with evidence from animal studies and observational studies, pralidoxin is useful. So for want of time, I am skipping the mechanism of action of organophosphorus. So coming to the paracetamol poisoning, the toxic dose is 200 mg per kg and the toxic compound is N-acetylparabenzoquinine. So there are four stages in paracetamol poisoning. Stage one, where the child will have GI symptoms like vomiting, malaise, and anorexia. After 24 to 48 hours, in stage two, the child will have resolution of the symptoms where he will have elevated AST and ALT and PTINR. In stage three, there will be peak elevation of liver enzymes with multi-organ dysfunctions. The child may die or recover. Recovery starts in stage three. In stage four, it occurs from 4 days to 2 weeks where the liver functions, abnormalities recover and child is clinically recovering. This is the Roux-Mac-Mathy nomogram. It is useful after a single toxic dose of paracetamol ingestion. It is used from 4 hours of ingestion up to 24 hours. So before that, if the child present, you send the samples for liver enzymes and wait for the paracetamol level after the 4 hours. So if you don't have a Roux-Mac-Mathy nomogram or the facility to measure the paracetamol levels, if the child is sick or having elevated liver enzyme, you can start N-acetylcysteine. When the liver enzyme started decreasing, you can discontinue N-acetylcysteine. The indication for liver transplant are when pH is less than 7.3 or INR more than 6 or child is having hepatic encephalopathy stage 3 or 4. Coming to the scenario 2, a 9-year-old child was brought with history of vomiting and abdomen pain. There was no history of fever. Child was clinically stable. There was jaundice and hepatomegaly. Liver enzymes were in 1000 and 1100s. PTA was more than 60 and INR more than 6. Viral markers were negative. So I was talking to the child, what happened to her? So the mother had a quarrel with the child and child took the Rattal poisoning. The Rattal poisoning contains yellow phosphorus. The toxic dose is 1 mg per kg. Even 30 mg for this 30 kg child is fatal. So this child was treated for vomiting and abdomen for 3 days outside. She presented to Jipper, where I was working at the time, at 76 hours. So usually, what is the antidote for Rattal poisoning? You can do exchange transfusion or N-acetylcysteine before 24 hours. Since the child presented after 72 hours, we tried for benefit of doubt. But this child didn't respond. She developed hepatic encephalopathy, refractory shock, and we lost the child after 9 days of hospital stay. So what are the stages of Rattal poisoning? Initially, in the first stage, she will have GI symptoms and smoky stools. In the second stage, it is symptom-free, where she can have elevated liver enzymes. And the third stage, she can have liver failure followed by multi-organ dysfunction like renal failure, metabolic acidosis, encephalopathy, and coagulopathy. Coming to the case scenario 3, a 2-year-old girl brought by mother with bluish discoloration of hands for the last 2 hours. On examination, airway was clear, breathing was normal, there was no added sound, cyanosis was present. So saturation was 83% with oxygen, circulation, there was tachycardia, perfusion and BP were normal. Disability, she was irritable and limb movements were normal. exposure showed a normal temperature, no abnormal cell, smell, and central cyanosis. So, cyanosis, low oxygen saturation, and normal PO2, we did co-oximetry. Methemoglobin level was 60%. So, this is a case of methemoglobinemia. The father was having some aphthous ulcers. He was using benzocaine, local anesthetic. It was very tasty, and child took about 2 to 3 grams. So, she presented with methemoglobinemia. So, this is the blood of the child. We are showing the chocolate brown color change of the blood. The column 3 and 4 are normal blood for comparison. So, what are the causes for methemoglobinemia? It occurs after organic or inorganic nitrates, chlorates, benzocaine, lidocaine, silver sulfur diazine after burns applications, and dapso. So, what is the problem here? Normally, iron contains ferrous form. In methemoglobinemia, the ferrous form is oxidized to ferric form, where it is unable to leave the oxygen into tissues. It causes tissue hypoxia, even though the PO2 is normal. So the ODC curve is shifted to left. The antidote is methylene blue at a dose of 1 mg per kg given over a period of 10 minutes. So rule out G6PD before giving methylene blue. So scenario 4, a 2-year-old boy from Rajasthan presented with fever for 1 day and seizures. Airway was stable, breathing was normal, there was no added sounds, circulation, tachycardia, no murmur, child was irritable. Exposure, there was paler, saturation was 78%, no cyanosis, PaO2 was 89, HP 3.2, a smear, emergency smear from the ER showed hemolytic picture, and lactate was 6.0. Can anybody guess what it is? So this is also methemoglobinemia. The purpose of putting the slide is, even though the saturation was 78, there was no cyanosis because you see, look at the HP, it was 3.2 because of the hemolysis. I was asking the father whether there was any exposure to naphthalene balls. He was unaware. So this child is from Rajasthan. G6PD is common in that place. So with a child with the tissue hypoxia, we took a call that we gave methylene blue. So do not wait for G6PD levels in a chick child with hypoxia. So we treated the child. The final diagnosis was naphthalene ball induced methemoglobinemia. The scenario 5, a 4-year-old female child, the mother gave, it occurred in the year 2016, mother gave odium leaves to the two daughters after a quarrel with her husband. So all the three were taken to Senchi GH and referred to Milapuram Medical College. They were treated symptomatically. On day 4, the mother expired. These two daughters were sent to Jipmer. At ER, the child was unresponsive, work of breathing was decreased, color was pale. She was intubated in ER. So I was unaware of what is odium leaves. So this is Clystanthus colinus. It belongs to, this is the leaf, the fruit. The tree usually grows up to 10 to 15 feet. So there is an adult study from Jipmer where over a period of 10 years, they could see about 51 cases of Clystanthus colinus poisoning. The mortality in this study was around 20%. So the manifestations should include hypokalemia, neutrophilia, leukocytosis, and AKI. So the Clystanthus colinus belongs to the euphorbaceae family. All the parts of these plants were poisonous. Most commonly, the leaves are used. The mortality in children is about 30%. So death occurs in 3 to 7 days. The active ingredients in this compound is Clystanthin A, Clystanthin B, and colinicin. So we had difficulty in managing child because of the proximal tubulopathy where they have severe hypokalemia, metabolic acidosis. With metabolic acidosis, we have to give soda bicarbonate. So in the presence of hypokalemia, so it is very difficult to bicarbonate. So the potassium levels were less than 2. So it lasted for 5 to 6 days. So the children with Clystanthus colinus poisoning were also have cardiac arrhythmias, encephalopathy, neuromuscular weakness, respiratory failure, and liver toxicity. We lost one of the daughters due to ARDS. So this is from CMC where they recommend treatment with for hypokalemia with potassium chloride, sodium bicarbonate for acidosis, dialysis for renal failure, arrhythmia management, intubation, and management of shock. So scenario six, 3-month-old female child was brought by well-educated parents with seizures for 15 minutes. ABC was taken care of. For disability, we gave lorazepam followed by 2 doses of lorazepam followed by fosphenytoin levetiracetam. There was strong odor of eucalyptus. On ST, the grandmother told she has applied some eucalyptus oil over the skin. So since there was ST of fever for the last 2 days, we initially thought of meningoencephalitis. So workup for meningoencephalitis was negative. EEG was normal. The final diagnosis was topical eucalyptus oil toxicity. Usually eucalyptus oil will cause status epilepticus when it was taken orally. In this small infant, even topical exposure will cause status epilepticus. Scenario 7, 1-year-old female child from Nellore, Andhra Pradesh had an accident consumption of coconut oil. She was asymptomatic for 24 hours, after which she had cough. She was taken to a nearby physician where he took some x-ray. It was normal, sent home. After 4 days, she developed respiratory distress and was brought to ICH. So this is the first x-ray showing ARDS. So child was intubated, but unfortunately we lost the child due to ARDS. Child developed type 1 pneumonia due to aspiration of coconut oil. Coming to scenario 8, a 2-year-old female child brought with history of accidental ingestion of mosquito repellent, that is all out. Usually the active component is pyrethroid, such as cypermethrin. So this all out and the mosquito repellents contains pyrethroid, which is more than 2000 times toxic to the insects rather than males because of the increased sodium channel sensitivity. So usually they are asymptomatic. If the child is just licking the rod, nothing will happen. Whereas some children, the rod is pulled out and they will drink the fluid. So in mild toxicity, they will have GI symptoms. Moderate toxicity, they will have CNS, depression, fever, sweating, and blood vision. Whereas in severe toxicity, you can have status epilepticus, coma, pulmonary edema, and even respiratory failure. Coming to scenario 9, a 7-year-old male child was brought with a history of lethargy, irritability, fever, and photophobia for 1 day. There was no history of neck pain or seizures. I was working in a GH. Initially, I thought of meningitis. On examination, airway was maintainable, work of breathing was normal. In cardiovascular system, CVS, there was tachycardia, hypertension, and warm peripheries, no shock, pupils were dilated. There was no specific smell, and the mucosa was dry. So initially, I thought of meningitis, and finally, it turned out to be because of the pupils, dilated pupil, I was asking the detailed history. So the child took the datron, that is thana pill. The seeds contain atropine, hyoscine, and scopolamine. The symptoms are delirium, mad as a matter, blind as a bat, red as a bee, hot as a hair, and dry as a bone. It is similar to sympathomimetics, where you can differentiate between anticholinergics and sympathomimetics by no sweating and a warm skin in anticholinergics, whereas cold skin and sweating in sympathomimetics. The antidote is 5-6-bit. At that time, we didn't have 5-6-bit. The child was managed symptomatically and was discharged home successfully. So we know that ORS saves billions of children with diarrhea. It is available in two sizes, 1 liter and 200 ml sachet. It is a real incident occurred to my friend. A 1-year-old boy was brought by parents with both our IT professional with acute watery diarrhea with some dehydration. So he's prescribed 1 liter sachet to be mixed with 200 ml water. Whereas they mixed 1 liter ORS solution in 200 ml water. So normally the ORS contains 75 milliequivalents, whereas because of the wrong composition, it was 375. Because of the dehydration, the child drank liters of ORS and brought with lethargy. Admission sodium was 179. The child was lost because of encephalopathy and cerebral edema and hemorrhage due to ORS poisoning. Coming to scenario 12, a 2-year-old girl from Kallakurichi, the mother was pregnant and was on oral iron. The child accidentally took 6 to 7 tablets of iron, referred to ICH after going to 4 hospitals because of the unavailability of desferoxamine. So this is the x-ray of the child where you can see the iron tablets in the abdomen. So it is radiopaque. an X-ray suspected iron poisoning is useful. So in iron poisoning, there are four stages of symptoms. Stage one will have GI symptoms, where stage two, there is resolution of symptoms. In stage three, they will have shock and metabolic acidosis. In stage four, liver failure. Later, they can have scarring and strictures. So the antidote is desferoxamine given at a dose of 15 mg per kg per hour. The indications are presence of metabolic acidosis or serum IL more than 500 microgram per deciliter. You can have allergy or hypertension or pulmonary fibrosis after desferoxamine. So when to stop desferoxamine infusion is resolution of metabolic acidosis, normalization of serum iron, improvement in clinical parameters or urine color changes to normal. This child present with the shock, we are giving fluid boluses. You see the initial color, urine color, and right side you can see the Winrose color of urine after the desferoxamine iron complex. So coming to the last scenario, 1.5 year old boy present with the accidental ingestion of thyroxine tablet. They were not sure whether it could be around 10 to 15 tablets. On admission, GCs were 15 over 15, heart rate and BP were normal, there were no tremors. We took a sample for thyroid function test 12 hours after that, where T3 and T4 were elevated and TSH was too low. So since the child was asymptomatic, we just observed and discharged the child. So we didn't start. The management includes stomach wash, activated charcoal, treat with propranolol, dexamethasone or propylthyroxine only if they are symptomatic. The thyroid function test will be hyperthyroid maximum at 48 to 60 hours and it falls. In campers toxicity, it is a component Vicks vaporer or in some paint box. The toxic dose is 30 mg per kg. Usually the symptoms occurs after 5 to 90 minutes. They can present with status epilepticus, ataxia or GI symptoms. Harpic, they can produce corrosive poisoning because of the hydrochloric acid, whereas in ALA, it's a common poison. Usually, they will be asymptomatic. It contains alkalis like sodium hydroxide, sodium hypochlorite. Most of them will be stable. In a series of ALA poisoning in Jimper, they were asymptomatic, but we did upper GI endoscope where we could see grade 3A and 3B esophageal injuries. To conclude, suspicion of poisoning is more important. History helps in many times. Antidote is available only in certain poisonings. Make sure the antidotes are available. Even if the expiry is there, it is more important for the life of the child when compared to the cost of the antidotes. Supportive care is equally important with antidotes and maintain child-friendly environment. So this is the National Poison Information Center in AIIMS, New Delhi. So the common antidotes available. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivasan, for that elaborate discussion on poisoning. And you nicely discussed the different case scenarios, the wide variety of cases that were managed. Thanks a lot. For short of time, I think we can have this discussion with respect to poisoning in children in the chat box. Now I just call upon the next speaker. Professor Narayanan sir, yeah. I think Dr. Srinivasan, you can stop sharing your slides so that